Well, good morning. Good morning. Good morning. Okay, well, Happy New Year for all that want to brave the new year, 2023. Congratulations that we've all made it into a new year. We have just one announcement, and maybe one and a half, because my second announcement will be a question to Pastor Dan. But the first announcement, the announcement that I know we have, is that our textual criticism class, Pastor Dan sent out an email on the church loop here, our textual criticism class is going to start next Sunday. It'll be at 1 o'clock, so grab a quick lunch and then meet back in the children's room back there, I believe, for that class, and start going through that class. So the book has been sent out. Grab the book, the third edition, not the most recent edition. Save yourself several hundred dollars, I imagine. So that'll be helpful if you're going to be in that class. Super interesting class. So if you're not familiar with textual criticism, super interesting. This is the class that gets you to understand, how do I know that the Bible really says this, that these words were really in the original writings. We don't have the original writings. How do we know, therefore, what were in the original writings? Right? How do we know that? There is actual scholarship that goes into it. It's fairly sophisticated, and that's what the class is going to be turning about. And by the way, that is the precise area in which particularly Islamic scholars attack. They go after higher and lower criticism. Dan's going to be focusing on the lower criticism, the textual criticism in this class, but it's a really interesting class if you're interested in that. The second one is, Dan, the men's prayer meeting is when?
We won't be having that this month.
Okay.
We'll put it off because Millicent's memorial is next Saturday morning.
Okay, so, thank you. That's right. Millicent's memorial next Saturday. Any other announcements from the body, from anyone? Yes, ma'am. So First Millicent's Memorial is next Saturday at First Baptist Church in Conroe. Okay.
At the end of First Street.
And we'll send out, I know that I saw the announcement and I saw the obit and I saw that there were even details in there. I think it's probably appropriate. We'll send out another set of instructions to make sure that everyone knows where that is. Good. Thank you for that, Peggy. Any other questions? Announcements from anybody? Okay, let's just open up in prayer. Father in heaven, we do thank you, Lord, for just joining us here in this place. We know, Father, where two or more are gathered in your name, that you're here in our midst and in our presence. And Father, we thank you for being in our midst, and also, Father, for showing mercy upon us, and for showering your grace upon us. We thank you, Lord, that your grace has allowed us to enter into a new year. We pray, Father, that this year would be a year filled with obedience and confession and living in a way that is pleasing to you and that brings you all the glory and honor that you deserve. Father, we do pray that we would worship you in spirit and in truth in this place this morning, for we ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, church, do we have the catechism? We're in the Heidelberg Catechism. And question number 53. Does anyone have 53 ready? Let's bring up the question and the answer. Let's just say this together, church. What do you believe concerning the Holy Spirit? First, that he is true and co-eternal God with the Father and the Son. Secondly, that he is also given to me to comfort me and live with me forever. Amen. Please stand up. Let's worship God in song.
Always be.
Church, we're going to have a time of prayer now, so I just ask that you take the next several minutes and go before our Father in heaven. And Pastor Dan and myself will be up front. If any of you would like for either one of us to pray with you and on your behalf, we cherish that opportunity. We'll make ourselves available here. presence and your grace upon us. We ask, Lord, that you would hear our prayers and that you would answer each and every one of them in accordance with your good and perfect and holy will. And Father, I pray that you conform our will to yours. They help us to be content with the answers that we get back from our many prayers. Be with us now, Lord, we ask, as we open up your word. Give each of us ears to hear and hearts to receive truth, so that each one of us might be conformed more to the image of your Son, Jesus Christ. For we ask these things in his name. Amen.
Well, good morning, church, and happy new year. If you have your Bibles, please turn to Psalm 130. I've been fighting a little bit of stuff, so pardon my voice this morning. I'm repenting now of canceling lunch. We've got a great turnout today, so should have just had lunch. I know you guys now are not partiers, so, well, except for maybe a couple of you. I got two texts at midnight. One was from a Lackney kid, and one was from, well, I won't mention her name, but her initials are Patty Carpenter. So, I don't know what they're doing up at that time of night, man. I had earplugs in. I was gone. I'm really grateful to God to be headed into the new year with you, my church family. I love you guys. I thank you so much for being so faithful. And God is just, I think he's just doing wonderful things here. It's been an exciting year this past year. I think we've added several new families to the church, and they're more visiting all the time. That's just so awesome. And if you join us next week, you can hear Pastor Mark tell us about the state of the church. We began that as a little tradition last year. And I took that up and just to have a sort of official sermon for the new year to tell us how the church is doing. And so you can look forward to that. This morning, I wanted to focus our thoughts on the new year and how to perhaps make the most of it. This is a sermon about hope. And hope seems to be in short supply in our world, doesn't it? A lot of people seem to express a lot of hope in perhaps the political process or a certain political candidate. Express hope that the prices at the grocery store or at the gas pump will come on back down. Hope that the stock market will return to normal. But in reality, not really a lot of those things are turning out for us, are they? And so it can be easy to lose hope. I had a recent encounter where I lost some hope I want to share with you. I went to see Santa the other day. True story. You laugh, but it's a true story. I sat beside him. He asked me not to sit on his knee. I don't know what that was about. So I sat there beside him, and he said, "What would you really like for Christmas, Dan?" I told him, "Well, my grandkids, they just love unicorns. They really do." And so if it's possible, I'd really love to have a unicorn for my backyard so that they could come over and maybe ride it and pet it and look at it. And Santa told me straight up, "Dan, there's no such thing as unicorns. What you're asking for is impossible." And so he asked me again, what else is on your list? I said, "Well, as you know," because Santa knows everything, right? "Well, I'm a really big fan of the Texas Tech Red Raiders. And I would really love to have the Raiders win a national championship in football sometime." Now, we got Aggie fans laughing at me right now. And so Santa leaned down and he whispered into my ear, "What color unicorn would you like?" Fortunately for us as Christians, we can have hope in this world. It doesn't rest in which political party's in power. It doesn't depend on who seems to be winning the day and the various culture wars that we're having out there. It doesn't even rest in our favorite football team. Our hope's in a different place. I wanted to give you four different ways that we can increase our hope in the new year. Those four ways are found in Psalm 130 this morning. Let's take a look at that passage together, beginning in verse 1. Out of the depths I've cried to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplication. You may notice, if you're looking at the heading of this psalm in your Bible, that it says Song of Ascents there. And we've talked about this before recently, actually. But I'll review for you. There are 15 psalms, Psalm 120 through Psalm 134, that are titled A Song of Ascent. And these songs were sung on the pilgrimage to Jerusalem, when the children of Israel were going up the mountain to the city. So they climbed to Jerusalem for a feast, be it the Feast of Weeks, the Feast of Booths. As they climbed up that mountain, they sang. Now, we don't know who wrote this particular psalm, Psalm 130, but it sounds a lot like David when you read it. King David had a lot of trouble in his life. Some of it he brought on himself. Other times the trouble came on him as a result of being king. David had lots of national enemies, those that would like to see him brought down, those who would like to see Israel enslaved. But one thing that seemed to be true of David is that he knew where to go when trouble hit. The psalmist today as well, whoever it is, knows who to cling to in times of trouble. A supplication, as the verse mentions here, is when we ask God for something. The word comes from the Latin word, supplicare. Supplicare means to plead humbly. We plead humbly with the Lord to hear our prayers and to answer them. One of the greatest tools that I believe I've ever found in praying is that what I call the ACTS method of praying. It's called that. You've probably heard of this. If not, I can highly recommend it as a method to more or less organize your prayers to God. ACTS is an acronym meaning adoration, confession, thanksgiving, supplication. We begin our prayer time by adoring the Lord. Sometimes this is as simple as reciting the attributes of God. Lord, you're faithful. God, you're so loving. You're good. You're just. God, you're eternal. You're all-knowing. You're all-powerful. And of course, any one of us here could go on and on for a while, couldn't we? We need a time where we recognize God for who He is and we adore Him for it. This is adoration. The next on that list is confession. And I'm going to pass over confession for now and come back to it because verses 3 and 4 deal with it. But the third there is thanksgiving, a time we set aside to be thankful for everything in our lives. God, I thank you for my family. I thank you for salvation. I thank you for my church. I thank you for my job and for your provision, not just today, but every day of the year. Every day can be thanksgiving for us. That's thanksgiving to the Lord, and it's good for us to set aside time for it in our prayer time, to be thankful, to be grateful to God. And that final letter in Acts is for supplication. And this verse is in front of us where we ask God for things. We humbly plead, as the word supplicare suggests. We recognize where our strength comes from. We recognize the only one who can truly hear and answer prayer. And we call on Him for help. You know, supplication, unfortunately, it seems to be where a lot of people begin and end their prayers. Fortunately, the average American oftentimes thinks of God as a giant vending machine. The growth of the prosperity gospel in this country and across the world, a false gospel that says that God will provide everything that you can think of if you just have enough faith. It's predominant here, and it's fatal for Christianity at its core. Because when God doesn't provide what is asked for, when He doesn't heal, when He doesn't dispense like a vending machine, it can be fatal to those with that view of the gospel. They can lose what faith that they did have. God is sovereign. God is not a vending machine. He will hear our supplications, each one of them, and He will always answer them. Church, hear me. God always answers our prayers. Sometimes the answer is no. Sometimes it's yes, and sometimes wait a while. We have to be okay with no and wait a while, recognizing that God knows what is best for His kids. He will always work things for His purposes and for our good. Scripture promises it. So we should actually be able to rejoice when we miss out on a job that we really wanted, recognizing God didn't want us in there in the first place. For whatever reason, and He knows what is best. We rejoice when we don't get the house that we wanted. We rejoice when we don't get the healing we ask for. Because we recognize that God has us in the palm of His hand. So hope for the new year is found in taking our cares to God and knowing for sure that He hears and answers our prayers in the way that He sees fit. Let's look at verse 3. If You, Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there's forgiveness with You that You may be feared. Here is our C in our Acts prayers, confession of sins. You know, we really live in a religion saturated society these days. There's a church on every corner here in the Bible Belt. There's a preacher on several channels on your TV all at once. If you want to attend church or you want to hear someone preach, there's almost no effort at all involved in it. But we're bringing up a generation of spiritual dwarves as well. Why is that? Because the gospel being preached is not the true gospel. It's saturated with feeling good about yourself. It's almost absent of one key ingredient. That is confession, repentance. And the need for repentance is many times glossed over by those preaching. They'll tell you, you just need to make a couple of corrections in your life and everything will be okay. You need to add Jesus, an ingredient. Just add Him to your already satisfying life. People are not made to see their need for a Savior. They're not hit with the depth of their own sinfulness. Most never hear the fact that without Jesus, you cannot see God. And there's no way to get to God without the intervention of Jesus Christ. Every single one of us are born into this world sinners in the sight of God. They used to speak in my old church growing up about the age of accountability. I don't know where that came from. I don't. This is a mythical age along about 10 years old where you became aware that you're a sinner and in need of a Savior. I'm here to tell you today the age of accountability is zero. It's when you're born. You're born accountable to God for the fact that you're drawing your first breath as a sinner on this earth. And without a Savior, I can offer you no hope at all. But if we truly repent of our sins, the Bible tells us that He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. And then the verse after that, verse 10, says, if we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar, and His word is not in us. We have no part with God if we are not made to feel the weight of our own sin. So all of those people walking around thinking they made a great choice by choosing Jesus as their Savior one day and signing a card and walking an aisle, they chose Him to avoid hell, but they have never made Him their Lord by surrendering their lives to Him, by repenting. They're in grave danger, let me tell you. They're living on borrowed time, and they need to repent and to truly recognize and acknowledge their sin before God. All of us do. All of us need to develop a practice of frequently repenting of our sins, asking for forgiveness from God. I have a confession to make to you today. Once in a while, not very often, Miss Peggy and I will have an argument. I know, sharp drawn breaths, right? Let me hasten to say, this is always my fault, okay? Because she's the perfect woman. I have tried my best to catch her. I have never once saw her slip up even once. But we're human. We don't always agree, but one of the things that's characteristic of our relationship, Peg and I, and I would say if you want to make it to 41 years, it's 41, right? Oh. You need to do this, too. We keep short accounts. We keep short accounts. And what I mean by that is neither of us can really stand it when we're not getting along. That gets under our skin terribly. One of us will quickly apologize for arguing. And then the other one will apologize right after that, not very long. And sometimes it's the sentence right after whatever it was we were arguing about. We don't like to fight. And we keep short accounts. We need to keep short accounts with God. There's a verse or two in Ephesians that applies to this really well. It says, be angry and do not sin. Don't let the sun go down on your anger. And give no opportunity to the devil. Now, that's speaking about, of course, arguing. We're not always mad at God when we're sideways with Him, but we need to be quick to repent. We need to not let the sun go down on our sin as well. We need to repent and be restored while the sun's shining on that day. Keeping short accounts with God is about recognizing, kind of like Martin Luther did, back in the day. We can't go through much of the day without sin. Martin Luther used to drive his priest crazy. If you haven't read about him, he would come in to do confession and he would realize on the way out he had sinned while he was in there. So he'd come back and do some more confession. And he drove him crazy like that. And we don't have to be that rigid about things. But we do need to keep short accounts before God. We need to be quick. Ask forgiveness from God, from those in our family when we blow it. Let me tell you, I've had to apologize to my sons many times for messing up when they were growing up in my house. I've had to apologize to my grandkids before. We need to be willing to even apologize to the littlest guy in our house if we have transgressed and done something wrong to harm or hurt. We need to be quick to ask God for forgiveness. This verse says there's forgiveness with God so that He may be feared. Now, this is not fear like you get watching a spooky show on TV or going to a haunted house. This is a healthy, needed reverence for God and His ability to move past our sins. The reason He marks them in the past is because He's provided the sacrifice for them in Jesus. He's not just ignoring our sins. He doesn't do that. They all have to be paid for, each and every one of them. But if we count on Christ's finished work on the cross to pay for our sins, then God doesn't mark them against us, as the first part of that verse says. And so all of this considered together, God hates sin, but He provided us with a way to be forgiven of our sin. And if we count on that way, which is Jesus, then He no longer charges those sins to our account. Now, this causes in us a healthy reverence for the Lord, and this healthy reverence then causes worship. And the worship has the right tone to it then, because we're reverencing God the way that we should reverence Him. Let's look together at verse 5. I wait for the Lord. My soul does wait, and in His word do I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning. Indeed, more than watchmen for the morning. When Peggy and I traveled over to Utah a few weeks ago on vacation, several things conspired to have us in bed by about 8 p.m. every night. First of all, we're kind of old, unlike Patty, who can stay up till midnight. I don't know if you've noticed that about us. Also, we were dog tired after hiking all day. We were just tired. And it's an hour earlier over in Utah compared to Houston. It was getting dark kind of early. So consequently, we were often up before daybreak, ready to go again. We were pounding on the door at Denny's. Let us in there. A couple of nights we were in Salt Lake City, staying at a hotel that faced the mountains to the east. And I could sit with the curtain drawn in the morning, and you could see the light beginning to come up over certain parts of the mountains there. And you just knew before long you were going to see the sunshine peeking up over that little peak there. Well, I sat there a half hour, and it never came up. Finally, about 30 minutes after that, it came up in a totally different place. It was over here when I was looking over here. I was anxiously waiting for the morning to begin so that we could go out and do some more stuff. What a beautiful place. And it just wasn't happening as quickly as I thought it should. And I thought about this verse, more than watchmen wait for the morning. The watchmen would be on the walls of the city watching for enemies in the darkness and waiting for daybreak. Their shift would end at daybreak. Someone else would come on, watch during the day while they slept. Then they would trade places again. And that verse sort of creates a certain longing in us, doesn't it? Watchmen waiting for the morning, for that first hint of daylight after a long night of watching. Our souls need to wait for the Lord. We need to wait on His salvation. And it may not come in our time frame. The sun may not peep over the mountains where we thought it would. We may be waiting on God to provide something in our lives, and it seems like God's just dragging His feet. When's it going to happen, Lord? When? You know, I felt that way sometimes about a new church building for us. I love where we get to meet here. I'm so grateful to God for it. It's not ours. I had issues this week. There was water spraying everywhere in here. When's it going to happen? I went by the property the other day and just sat there in the driveway and prayed, Lord, please. And my supplication just seems to be on hold. And I know God, I know He has a perfect time, a perfect plan. And we need to wait on Him. But some days it's hard for me as a human. I want it to happen on my time schedule. It's just not happening when I think it ought to. But I think it will happen. And I have a verse of scripture that I cling to in the waiting. Lamentations. Try that again. I didn't practice that one enough this week. Such a beautiful reminder. Many of you have heard at least a part of this, but perhaps never heard how it ends. It's a gorgeous ending. This I recall to mind Therefore, I have hope. The Lord's loving kindnesses indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They're new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I have hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him. To the person who seeks him, it's good that he waits silently for the salvation of the Lord. It's good for me to wait quietly on the Lord. It's good for you to wait on him. It's good for us to hope in him and in his word, because these things never fail. God's word has never failed. God's promises are true. In the book of 2 Corinthians, Paul says about his promises that they are yes and amen. They're as good as done. My daughter-in-law, Amber and Jay, my son, told me a couple of weeks ago that they were expecting. I don't know if that's news to you. Happy New Year. It was happy for me. We're certainly rejoicing over getting to be grandparents again, but they really probably shouldn't tell me these things so early because I'm a lousy waiter. We now have to wait till July before we can see that kid. I want to see him now. I don't do so good waiting. We need to do a better job of waiting on the Lord, hoping in God, putting our trust in him, leaving the results up to him. Some of the Christian songs these days have some really lousy theology in them. That's probably not news to you, but I listen to the radio sometimes, and there's this one song on there that says something about turning loose and giving God the control. We don't control anything, folks. We don't turn anything over to God for him to control. We don't give God control. He has control. We just need to learn to recognize that and to wait patiently for the salvation of the Lord. Sing about that. That's what I want to hear. That's in every area. Finances, work, family, possessions, when your next grandkid comes, you name it. God controls it all, and we have two responses. We can wait patiently, or we can wait impatiently. Either way, God is going to work things out in his perfect time. So we wait on the Lord. The final way to increase our hope is found in verse 7. Let's look there. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there's loving kindness. With him is abundant redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. The psalm has now grown from a personal call to hope in the Lord to a national call to hope in him. We need to be faithful witnesses of the goodness and the faithfulness of our God to those around us. We need to encourage others to place their hope in the only trustworthy source. You're probably aware as a Christian, you see it all the time, how negative the world around us has gotten about offering encouragement to one another. Never been that great to begin with. It's worse now. Man, it's rough out there. If you put anything on social media or if you make a comment on a news story, you put yourself out there at all, you are going to be mocked roundly. And you see some of these talent shows on television, people sitting in the audience mocking the people on stage. They're putting themselves out there, and the people in the audience are going, oh, I can do better than that. In regular public school, the bullying is relentless, and it's always been kind of that way, honestly, and been terribly that way. I experienced a lot of bullying when I was in school. I think the difference for me was, at least where some of these kids don't have it, I had a safe place. I always had a spot where I could come home and be myself and do dumb things in my room and be goofy and silly, and I would not be mocked for them. The world these days is just so serious and so demanding. You know, there's some of these social media influencers is what they call them. Very much like an online popularity contest these days. Cool kids will try to influence your decision to purchase a product by displaying it themselves. They wear certain clothes or shoes. They'll use a certain phone or type of makeup. And the comments to those people is so bad at some points that some of them have committed suicide. That's honestly the case. That's how bad it is in the world right now. And so we as Christians, we need a safe haven. We need a place where we can gather and feel it's safe from the criticism that's so very rampant everywhere. We need a place where we're encouraged to hope in the Lord, to place our trust in the one who's deserving of it. We honestly need a place where the Lord himself is not mocked, and we're not mocked for believing in him. As a Christian, we should have every confidence that we can recommend the Lord to other Christians around us, recommend hoping in him. We know that he's good and caring and loving and compassionate. We know that we can trust the lives of our friends and family in the Lord's hands. He'll never steer them the wrong direction. And so our interactions with God are safe in his hands. Our interactions with others in this place, our church family, should be safe. We should be the most encouraging church family on the planet right here. It needs to recharge and refresh us when we gather together. It should never be a drain or a discouragement. This time together in church should be the highlight of our week every week. And if it's not, we should work to fix that together. The Apostle Paul, he spent a part of his letter to the church in Rome encouraging others to be an encouragement to one another. And this is what he says: be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, practicing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. We've been doing some of that here lately, haven't we? Weeping with those who weep, weeping alongside them. And I think our very best friends should be from the church, those whom we have the most confidence in, those we can confide in. The spiritual gift of encouragement should belong to each of us in increasing measure. And it should be liberally poured out on our brothers and sisters around us. We should also be accountable to one another in terms of conduct and our actions. We should be willing to get in each other's business if it's called for to call a brother or sister back to holy living. Living in community. Living in community with one another, it's not the path of least resistance, let me tell you that. It's the path of blessedness as a church. Love one another. Pray for one another. Hold each other's arms up. We're not all going to lose a loved one all at the same time. And so we can support and care for those who are grieving currently. And when you're grieving, you can expect the same from them. So much good to be said about living in community, a community of believers who genuinely care about one another. It's like family. We are like family here. So how hopeful are you today going into 2023 that it's going to be a good year? You see, it really doesn't matter who's in the White House. Doesn't depend on who follows you on Twitter. It only depends on who's on the throne of heaven. Because the one that's on the throne of heaven is the same yesterday in 2022, the same today in 2023, same forever. thank you for this new year, a year to live and grow with you, God. We recognize when we open our eyes up in the morning, it's a day, Lord, where we can serve you and love you, and love on the people around us. And we pray, Lord, we will do that well this year. Lord, that we will have hope for the new year. Not hope in other people or a process, God, but hope in you. Hope in your word. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.